views expressed on the following program are not necessarily those of WPSL, but you're encouraged to like and share them on Facebook, because it's time for the Sue Ellen Sanders Show with Sue Ellen Sanders.
Welcome to the Sue Ellen Sanders Show, and I've got a guest with me today who is going to be talking about one of my favorite subjects, and that's puppies. Puppies. And David Lynch is the shelter manager and also the director of special events and other special activities for the Humane Society of St. Lucie County. And this is, by the way, there are several locations in St. Lucie County, but the one in Port St. Lucie, the yellow place, that's like on, is it Selfis?
Midway? Glades Cutoff.
Glades Cutoff. One. And the location just off Savannah Road. Those are the only two locations for the St. Lucie County Humane Society. And all of the funds raised for special events for the St. Lucie County Humane Society, or Humane Society of St. Lucie County, whatever you want to call it, go to the dogs and cats and animals that are supported in the shelters in St. Lucie County and St. Lucie County alone. And I make that connection because, you know, everybody's looking out for puppies. Everybody's looking out for cats. They're looking out for the strays. They're looking out for learning responsible pet ownership. And so, you know, it's great that there are humane societies in every location. But if you want to visit the local humane society, mm-hmm. and you're living in St. Lucie County, then those are the locations for you, right?
Absolutely. It's always important to support your local charities. Not many people know this. They think that we're, just because we have the name Humane Society, that we're affiliated and get funding from the National Humane Society organization. As that's a common misconception, because I think the statistics are that the HSUS, Humane Society of the United States, only 1% of funds that they raise go to local animal shelters, and that's only through grants. Everything else goes through their lobbying efforts, or, you know, their humane investigations. So when you see the sad TV commercials, just know that if you do donate, it's the money's not staying local.
It doesn't come down to the St. Lucie County Humane Society.
No, there's no trickle down effect at all. It's always important to support your local Humane Society. Keep the money local, because it really helps take care of the pets in our community, which there are thousands of homeless pets that we receive every year. Last year, we received exactly 5,000 cats and dogs. Unfortunately, this year, we're seeing an increase of animals coming into our shelter, and it's mostly from an increase in owner surrenders, people moving, financial hardships, they can't care for their pets, or just, you know, you hear a plethora of reasons, some of them justified, some of them not, and we're really getting slammed with owner surrenders this year, so we're probably looking at a projection of about 5,500 animals this year.
Wow, that's a lot of animals. And, you know, there are other shelters that are in the area that probably don't have as many animals that are brought in. But your shelter particularly, you offer other services other than just housing those animals. You also offer low-cost pet care services.
Yes.
So that's one of the things I like about the Humane Society of St. Lucie County, and their mission is teaching and helping make responsible pet care affordable. Mm-hmm. And then you actually have specials all the time for adopting dogs and cats. Mm-hmm. There's certain times a year where all the cats are free or low cost, and there's certain times a year where there's a discount on adult dogs. There's also a discount for seniors, not just dog and cat seniors, but senior adults who are adopting.
It's our Senior for Senior program, where anybody 65 and older can adopt a pet that's 5 years or older, and there's no fee, adoption fee at all.
Yeah.
It's important, you know, companionship between humans and animals, seniors, adults, children. I think that, you know, when I always have fond memories of growing up, and I've always had, you know, pets around, and they were always a big part of my life growing up. So yeah, we always try to do adoption specials just to, one, you do want to draw more attention to our shelter for adoption, because we constantly are getting in more and more animals. We never turn an animal away. So when a stray animal is picked up by our local animal control officers, or if people need to surrender a pet, if there's no other resource for them to go to, if other shelters are full, we don't turn them away. So it's important for us to, once they get in, evaluate them, do health checkups, and try to get them, we call it, live outcomes, as quick as possible. And that's really important. So when we do adoption specials, we usually strategically place it around times of the year where adoptions are slow and intake's high, to try to stimulate more adoptions. You know, we do get some pushback from people who claim that we're just giving away pets for free. How can we tell if people can really care for them? And thankfully, organizations like Best Friends Animal Society, which we're a network partner with, has put in a lot of money into research, and there's been plenty of studies that show that people who spend $500, $150, or $5 for an adoption fee, the return rate is the same, the amount of care that they put into the pet is the same. So really, adoption fees aren't a good measure of if somebody's able to care for a pet. And honestly, we've had tremendous success. That's why our adoption numbers are up every year. I think this year compared to last year, from the year to date, our adoptions are up by 15%. So, and that's really because we're just doing name your own price adoptions, highlighting more pets, not labeling certain, like we've actually stopped labeling dogs that people look at as like pit bulls, because one, we don't know what their breed is. Mm-hmm. We don't do DNA testing. And there's a lot of HOAs and apartments out there that complexes that don't allow certain breeds.
So if you call them mixed breed, mm-hmm. or mixed shepherd or lab mix or something that you think might be part of it, then you know, because I honestly, dogs that have some pit bull or chow or mixed breed are some of the sweetest, kindest, most
Absolutely.
Loving dogs. And a puppy, especially if you're raising it for a puppy, but even when the dogs are a little bit older, you get what you put into it. Mm-hmm. So if you treat that dog with love and care and treat it responsibly, it's gonna react that way in almost every kind.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, like I have a pit bull. He is the laziest couch potato you will ever meet. He thinks he's a lap dog. He, you know, sits in my lap, sits all over me pretty much.
How many pounds?
He's about 65-70 pounds in that
65
range.
65-pound lap dog.
Yeah.
That would be interesting.
There's about 2 inches on the couch for space. He will fit in there.
He will fit.
He is
yeah.
determined. It's how they're raised, which is important for us to educate the community on how to take care of a pet, you know, how to socialize them, because you know, whenever we see a dog that comes in that's aggressive, it's not the pet's fault. That's a, you know, society issue. Like a human failed them, we mm-hmm. failed them, and that's the problem. Like yeah, this is a, you know, a pet overpopulation is a man-made problem, and only we can fix it. So yeah, it's a shame when we see a truly like aggressive dog or neglected dog come in. Somebody didn't take the time and love that dog like the way that they deserve.
And you read about the things that, you know, the woman that's discovered with 70 pets in her car, or 70 cats
yes.
in her car, or a house where they have all the dogs that are overrun, or you know, some type of pet situation that, you know, there's so many pets and they're not being taken care mm-hmm. of, and they don't have any personal contact, and, you know, they're turned over to organizations, and a lot of times they're funneled to the Humane Society mm-hmm. or other organizations who could take care of them. You know, what stands out to me, one of the things that you said about, you know, that some people are objecting to having specials for adopting pets, but even if you're paying $5 for that pet at the Humane Society, you still have to fill out an application.
Absolutely.
Even to look at a pet, mm-hmm. you have to fill out that application.
That's what we always stress. Just because the adoption fees are low doesn't mean that our policies and procedures are thrown out the window. They still have to meet all of our requirements to adopt a pet. So it's not like we're just opening the door and handing everybody who comes in an animal. You know, our staff and volunteers have put a lot of time caring for him, treating them for any medical issues that they've had, and getting them ready for adoption. So the last thing we want to do is just put them in a bad environment where they're going to be neglected or abused or ultimately returned to the shelter, and we're back to square one.
And whether you're paying $5 or $50 or $150 for your animal, you still are encouraged to bring all the family members to meet the mm-hmm. pet before adoption, and also all the other canine family members as well, to make sure that there's not any issues. And if I sound like I'm talking from a place of experience, yeah. it's because I am the proud owner. Our family has 3 different rescue dogs from the Humane Society of St. Lucie County, and we love them all. And at some point during the show, I think Cliff is going to show the Christmas picture of the 3 rescue puppies. First one, Lucy, is 4 years old, and my daughter, when she was home from college for the summer, I think sophomore year or something like that, she was on a campaign to get a dog, and my husband said, well, she can't take it back up to school with her, and so we ended up being, you know, in charge of the dog when she went back up to school. Lucy was a little high strung. She's a red, appropriately, and we took the name that the Humane Society had given her. She's beautiful red hair, grew up to be a beautiful dog. But she is high strung and high energy. And I think she has maybe a little bit of greyhound in her, but she's definitely a mix. And, then 2 years later, when my daughter graduated college and went away to grad school, she had the ability to take the dog with her to grad school in DC. And so she took, and all that summer I knew Lucy was leaving us, and that was 2 years ago. So I was on a campaign to get another dog. And while I was looking for the perfect puppy for me, checking out the Humane Society, by the way, you have an awesome website with all the pictures and all the information about all the dogs and cats. And you can put in different qualifiers, how old you want, mm-hmm. Whether you want a male or a female, or you can just go through all the pictures. And sometimes there's videos too. So we found, while we were looking for our dog, I found another dog, and I knew my son, who lives locally but lives on his own, was looking for a puppy, and I found Charlie. And you were actually, David, you were there when Jake adopted Charlie.
Yes. Yeah, I remember it was a Saturday morning. He was there bright and early, because I think we announced that the date when he was going to be, when Charlie was going to be available. And your son was very determined.
Yes,
he showed
he
up very early. He was the first one there. And by 11:30, he had a new friend. And Charlie, you know, they're just the sweetest dog, gets along with everybody. Because I know, you know, Jake always takes him mostly everywhere.
Yeah.
And everybody loves him. And it's insane to think that somebody actually just threw away Charlie in our front play yard. It didn't even turn him in when we were open. I remember coming in one morning and there was this scared little beagle in our play yard that was there probably all night in the dark but couldn't be any sweeter. And I mean, pets are just so resilient. No matter what they go through, they still trust us and want to love us. And I mean, you know, what a sweet dog to add to the family.
Well, and we were talking about too, about, you know, some people aren't, you know, in a living situation to have pets. And mm-hmm. I thought, you know, here is my, at that time, 20, 2-year-old son, and he's off on his own, and how well is he going to take care of a pet? But, you know, I thought, well, I'll be the backup plan. You know, we can always bring Charlie. And he named Charlie because, of course, you didn't know the name because he had just been abandoned. And puppies are in high demand when they're at the Humane Society, so that's why Jake kind of had to wait to get him. But Charlie changed my son's life. You know, made him a more responsible person, and because he found himself responsible for another living human being, and this young adult who, you know, probably couldn't keep a plant alive is doing a bang up job after 2 years with Charlie, and the two of them are, you know, they're a team, and they go around, and Jake takes them to like chamber events and wherever he can take them. Charlie's an active guy. And then a couple weeks later, we found another dog for us because it was obvious that Charlie and Jake were working out. And we're thinking of sticking with the Peanuts theme because we had Lucy and then we had Charlie. But then we adopted, and he was called a shepherd mix. And we adopted Sammy, and he's actually named after Sam's Club because we couldn't think of a good name for him, and I pulled into the Sam's Club parking lot.
It's a sign.
I know. So Sammy is the third of our rescue pups. And so the picture that, if you're listening, you'll see a little bit later on is of the three rescue pups last year in their Christmas sweaters. Yes, it was 90 degrees for Florida Christmas. My daughter was visiting with Lucy, and Jake had Charlie over, and I, being the dog grandma, bought them all matching Christmas sweaters. So
an adorable picture.
They were going to wear those Christmas sweaters. Really tells a lot about their personality. It tells a lot about the variety of animals that are available. Of course, and, you know, I'm talking about dogs, but there are a lot of cats.
Yes.
And adoptable cats. And they're on your website, too, so you can go through those and... There's a lot of needs that the Humane Society has because, you know, as you said, you have to pay the bills on your own. You don't get a trickle down from the American Humane Society. You have to support yourselves. But also there's a lot of other needs that people might not think of. And there's drives you do from time to time, but then all year round you need things like blankets and stuffed animals and stuff like that for the dogs and cats that are there.
Yeah. Any blankets, towels, you know, I know a lot of people call and they're ready to throw them away. And no, we can make good use of any blankets and towels that you think that you can donate. You know, we use them. It really comforts the animals. We can use them in our clinic area, and then you know, enrichment items like toys, especially the durable kind. Because man, if you give some of these pets the toys, they'll make quick work of it. So anything durable, like a Kong toy or hard rubber material, is perfect for dogs. And then cats, you know, we take catnip, any cat toys. This time of year, like you mentioned about the cats, statistically we usually take in about probably about every two cats, one dog. So it's much
a
more
lot,
yeah.
Lot of cats.
And this is the time of year known as kitten season. So once spring comes, although in Florida, since the weather is always, you know, mild, you know, to hot, we always usually see it year round where places up north when they have a winter time, and then spring comes, and then that's when they start seeing a lot of cats turn in. I mean, really for us, it starts in February where we start getting litters of kittens in and abandoned cats. And right now a big need is just fosters, and we have a great foster program, and which just entails if you know, you just provide your home and love and care, and we'll provide everything else, whether it's food, litter, medical care is all covered through that program. And it really allows the kittens to grow up in a stress-free environment. You know, they get housebroken, they're not surrounded, you know, the shelter, there's so many animals in there that There's so much bacteria and germs that kittens are exposed to, and their immune system is just too weak.
Yeah.
And they're easily susceptible to upper respiratory infections. So that's why it's important to recruit more fosters, because once they come in, we can call them, get them out of the shelter as soon as possible, and they can grow up in a stress-free, healthy environment until they're old enough for adoption. And then you can either return them to the shelter, take them to events. We have weekly events at Petco and PetSmart and other community events. And that we really facilitate a lot of adoptions that way. Or you can be a foster failure. I'm a 2-time foster failure with dogs, where I took them into my home and then I got attached to them and couldn't.
It was funny because I was going to ask you about mm-hmm. that, but I wasn't really going to use that term. I was going to say, is there ever a time where where the foster parent is able to adopt the pet?
Yeah, they have first right of refusal. If anybody shows interest in a foster, we always let them know. And it's funny because usually more times than not, when we'll call and say, hey, somebody's interested in the pet that you have, they'll say, oh, no, they're mine.
Yeah.
They're mine. I'm adopted.
Oh, yeah. It pushes it forward. Yeah. I got to make a decision. I've got to move on from this. And, you're talking a little bit about seniors and their attachment mm-hmm. to dogs or pets. One of the other thing I like about the staff at the Humane Society is they're all so familiar with the animals, and you go in there and you might say to them, you can walk up and down and look at the animals in their kennels as well, but you might say, hey, I'm looking for, my mom is, 70 and lives in a small condo, and I'm looking for a cat that's going to be loving and want to sit on her lap all day. Mm-hmm. And, that same cat that is like a perfect match for the woman who's at home and wants a cat to sit on her lap all day might not be the perfect match for someone who's got a busy lifestyle. And then every time no one's at home, the cat destroys things to punish the family mm-hmm. for leaving them. So the Humane Society, both the staff and the volunteers, have an idea of somewhat of the personality of the pets that are living in each of the shelters too.
That's one thing we've started doing over the years, is getting our volunteers more involved in the adoption process. A lot of them spend just as much time as the staff does with them. They know the animals. So why not get them more involved? It's very rewarding for them to see a pet that they've been caring for several weeks or months find a home. And, it really just allows us to provide better customer service, as well as tend to the needs of a client who comes in looking to adopt. We can point them in the right direction, or maybe give them, like you said, a pet that more fits their lifestyle.
So that leads us to something else that would be good to talk about is the volunteers. So mm-hmm. in addition to needing, things like dog, cat beds, toys, blankets, towels that can be donated, you also can use volunteers. And a lot of teenagers now are required with Bright Futures or with the program that they're involved in with their school to have service hours. And a lot of them don't think beyond what's right in front of them, and they don't realize that you can volunteer for the Humane Society and be around animals and come and walk dogs. What are some of the other volunteer opportunities you have?
So walking dogs, socializing cats, we allow them to bathe them, help evaluate animals. They can help clean the kennels. They can also come and take dogs out and during the day, like let's say if I have an hour or two, I can come in, take out a dog that's ready to go home and take them to Petco or, even Archie's, any pet friendly establishment. I remember one time when I was volunteering, I just had a little min pin with me, and while I was walking down downtown Fort Pierce and just found the dog at home right there. Somebody chased me down and scared me a little bit because they were so excited. But
I want that dog.
Yeah.
You should have little, it would be hard to get the size, but maybe little scarves made that say, I'm adoptable. Adopt me, So when a volunteer is walking with a dog,
it's easily identifiable.
That would be cool. That's a neat idea. So, of course, it's just one more thing that costs money. And money, you know, the Humane Society is always looking for funds to support keeping both shelters open and the supplies and the dog food. And before I forget, too, one of the other things that people can donate to you, say, for example, if you just bought like one of those 50-pound bags of dog food and then your dog passed away or, you know,
or
decided,
rejects it,
doesn't like that dog food, you can donate dog food, too.
Yes. Yeah, we any donated food we use for our foster program in-house as well. And also we make individual bags as well, because we have people in our community who are they might have some financial hardships or fallen on tough times, and we want to try to keep people's pets in their home and not in the shelter, so they'll come to us and we'll supply them with pet food.
So kind of like food bank for the pet.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so that's very cool. Well, it all costs money to do. Mm-hmm. And that's why the Humane Society has different special events throughout the year that
yes.
you can support. And one of them is coming up right around the corner this coming weekend. And is this the first time you're doing this event?
Yes, it's the first time we're doing this. I know some of our other Humane Societies, one in Brevard County and Furry Friends down in Jupiter, they do the dog surfing event. And I was invited on Easter weekend to go up and just see what it was all about, and I was a little skeptical at first, but after seeing it, I've never seen something that was just so, it just drew your attention to it. And it was actually tied around a pro-am, and when
there was a people surfing event that
and nobody when people were out there, you know, you had some families and family and friends watching the competition. But once they got the dogs out there, the beach was just packed, and you could hear a pin drop. Everyone was just camera, you know, phones out, taking pictures. Just, and it was, I mean, some of these dogs are very talented. They were better than some of the humans.
So Saturday, June 16th.
Yes, Saturday, okay. June 16th at Pepper Park. It starts at 8:30. The surfing competition will probably start around 9:15. You know, it is a pet-friendly event, so bring your pet out there as well. And it's going to be a lot of fun. We already have some champion dog surfers registered. We have one named Waldo, who he's won, I think, the Brevard competition twice, and he's competing in Furry Friends. And this might actually be his swan song. So he's hoping to retire. He's been at it for about 9 years, his owners told me. And so he's looking to go out on top. So he's going to have some stiff competition. And we encourage people to register. They can go to our website, www.hssslc.org, to register. And if your pet is a beginner or has never surfed before, we are offering surf lessons the morning of the event. So you can even register.
How fun is that? So surf lessons for your pet. Because that was one of the things that was going through my mind is how does one become a surfing dog?
How do you know if your dog will even, like, for instance, my dogs, I know probably are not going to even be interested in surfing, because when I took them to Walton Rocks Beach, they saw the waves and they just took off the other direction.
My dogs, none of our family dogs like the water. Charlie likes the water, but I don't think he would go into the ocean, but he likes the water. And Lucy, who doesn't live in Florida now anyhow, she likes lapping at the waves. But boy, Sammy, when he sees the waves coming at him, he wants to leave the beach. He's not a fan of it either. So obviously, those are not the type of dogs you want to put on a surfboard and put out in the ocean.
Those would probably be the spectators.
Yes, those would be the spectator dogs, who they probably find it really interesting. I certainly will, and I think it's fascinating. So, like Waldo and these people who have surfing dogs or are surfing dogs, how did they get started with this? How had surfing dogs been around for a while?
That's a good question. I think they said that they just they're surfers themselves, and I think that they just took him out one time on paddling around the board and saw that he wasn't afraid to be out there, and then I guess somebody had a crazy idea to make it a competition, and he just found a hidden talent.
You know, it's hard enough for a human being with two legs to stand on a surfboard.
Oh yeah, I would. I look at them doing that, and I don't even want to attempt it because I'll probably end up with some bumps and bruises.
I wonder if it is harder or easier with a dog with four legs. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously the balance would be a little bit easier on the surfboard.
Yeah. So the one that won the Easter competition that I attended. Her name was Surf Pig, and she was a three-legged Jack Russell mix.
Oh, so I bet her balance was really good. She said, but three—that's interesting. So, what other breeds did you see in the surf competition?
There was a Chocolate Lab, a Yellow Lab, a Jack Russell Terrier, a Wheaton Terrier.
So we know labs. Labs are probably good with the water, with the surfing.
And then a little Chihuahua who was having a difficult time and was kind of instead of swimming back to the owner when he fell off the board, he was headed to the towards the shore. I think he had enough.
And how are you making money on that? I mean, obviously the pets aren't paying to enter the competition. Yes. Are there pet parents?
So the competition is a $25 registration, a donation. And then any pet to 10 is, we're just asking for a $5 donation to register that way. And then Dyer Subaru has, they're the title sponsor of the event. And, the county really partnered with us to lower fees, so all the profits go to the Humane Society. And this being the first year, it was kind of on short notice. We were approached to do it by this East Coast Dog Surfing Association. We really wanted to make the event for the Humane Society, and we thought it'd be a cool way to get more exposure. So this year, the fundraising aspect of it might not be a lot, but I think the exposure and the community involvement will be the real key for this event.
It'll kind of be more of a fundraiser than a fundraiser.
Exactly. Because the more events that we do where people can bring their pets to, I think the better for us, because we have a lot of new initiatives that we want to get out in the public. Like our board of directors just approved a 5-year strategic plan that we put together with the end result to becoming a no-kill shelter, which is very big, especially for an open admission shelter. And the goal is to get to a 90% live release rate. So 90% of the animals that come into the shelter will be out either transferred to other rescues, adoptions, return to owners, things like that.
So return to owners after the owners are have learned the pet responsibility, or they've gotten that extra leg up if they needed food or supplies.
We've really been researching what a lot of other shelters who have had great success reaching no kill status, what they're doing. The ones that, because we don't want to get away from being a shelter that never turns away an animal. We want to be there for any animal that's in need. So we don't want to just say, hey, we're full, we can't take this animal, sorry, we're trying to be a no-kill shelter. We want to be the ones that are still servicing the community and providing more resources. So one shelter actually does scheduled appointments for owner turn-ins, so that when somebody tries to turn in their pet, they give them an appointment date, they have them fill out a form, and that form asks questions like, is there something that you need or lacking? They give them a resource pamphlet with food pantries, other local rescues that might be able to help them, dog trainers as well. So if somebody's turning like, my animal's just, my dog's just too much for me, I can't handle him, then there you go. There's information about local dog trainers that can help him out. If somebody needs food and can't afford it, well, hey, let's figure out what we can do to keep the pet in their home. Is it that we need to give the pet owners low cost vaccines or food or other care that we can provide for them? Let's do that, because one way or another, if an animal has an illness that we can treat, and that's what's stopping them from staying in a home, well, when it's in our shelter, we're going to treat it anyway. So why not help? Let's help out people. Let's not get our shelters overcrowded. And, we have to have more resources for pet owners out there. And there's a lot that we need to start reaching out to our local governments about, especially with cats. A lot of communities have TNR programs, trap, neuter, and return for feral cats.
Mm-hmm.
Fort Pierce legalized it last year, the program really hasn't gotten off, but St. Lucie County and Port St. Lucie, cats have the same leash laws as dogs, which is kind of crazy to think about, because anytime I talk to a cat owner, half of them have an indoor-outdoor cat. They're letting their cats roam and then come back home later in the day. Well, they're not realizing that they're putting their cat at risk, because if somebody sees a cat, they can call. A cat can be trapped, picked up, then brought to the shelter, and they might not know the cat's missing for days, which is unfortunate. So that's something that I think that we need to change. The idea is, let's not, you know, the cat is healthy, happy, let's and being taken care of, and it's vaccinated and spayed or neutered and not adding to the overpopulation problem, then let's keep it in its happy environment. And if it needs to be spayed or neutered, then trap it, bring it to the shelter, and then re-release it. Let's not bring it into a shelter environment that it's not going to respond well to. It's a strange environment. I always tell people, how would you feel if somebody snatched you up, put you in a strange place, and didn't tell you where you were or why you're here? We wouldn't react to that very well. So we really got to work with our local governments to get these ordinances changed. And I think we would see a big increase in the amount of cats that we're able to save.
So in the best case scenario with as far as local ordinances would be to be able to provide those services and let the cats remain in their homes. And, you know, the whole idea of a leash law, I know we had a cat that was a back porch cat, and he knew how to use the doggy door to go in and out. And, you know, he would go out and then he would come back in. And he would usually spend the night on the porch. And then when it was cold, he slept inside. But he much preferred being outside. Mm-hmm. That's what he wanted to be, is an indoor-outdoor cat. And his indoor was really the back porch. It wasn't inside the house, because he wasn't happy inside the house. And there's some cats, especially the cats that have grown up in a less restrictive environment, that are used to that. Mm-hmm. And they're not very happy when they're more restricted, and they have a tendency a lot of times, if they really want to be out, they're punishing their owners, they're punishing the house, they're trying to get out of the house.
Absolutely. And as long as they're, you know, a lot of these cats might even have been born outside. They might not have been domesticated. Mm-hmm. So at that point, what's the difference between that animal and other wildlife? It's the environment that they're used to. And as long as they're not, you know, endangering anybody, like, you know, a risk to anybody's health or well-being, and not, you know, attributing to the overpopulation problem, then I think that'll be okay. Because currently the ordinances of just trapping and bringing to the shelter, you're not fixing the problem. There's still an estimated, you know, 50,000 cats that are outdoors. And it does create a problem for wildlife, because cats are, you know, they are natural predators to birds and other species, which usually why people who are wildlife advocates are against a TNR program. But a TNR program, the main goal is to drop that population outlets, you know, end the reproduction cycle. And, you know, I think it's a win-win for everybody. It's a win for the shelter, and it's a win for the animals. It's the right thing to do. And so I look forward in the next couple of weeks to, you know, meeting with our county commissioners and city officials, and just kind of going over and educating them on a program. And even if we can get a pilot program started, that would be a huge win. We're looking at, you know, probably over like 1,100 cats that lives would be saved just by enacting these new laws.
It can make quite a difference in their lives and in the population. And then, you know, the whole thing that comes back to are the families and the people, mm-hmm. whose lives can be changed by having the interaction with the pet.
Absolutely. And then if the intake goes down, that's more attention and resources can be paid towards the pets in the shelter that are there for, you know, owner surrenders, or that are going to be there one way or another. I truly believe that the animals that are trapped and brought to the shelter that have are indoor outdoor cats. You know, they don't belong. They don't belong in that environment. You know, it's kind of just, it's not the right thing to do. We should be focusing on the animals that are being taken from cases of either a hoarding case or neglect case, or truly somebody's ran out of options. Our attention needs to go towards getting those pets healthy and getting them up for adoption.
It is. There are a number of different special events that the Humane Society hosts over the years. And one of the big ones that's probably the most longstanding is the Fur Ball.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Which is it a spring event?
It's traditionally in March. This year is going to be the first weekend in May. And it's going back to, it's going to be back at the Pelican. Last year it was at a PGA village. But this year it's going to go back to the Pelican Yacht Club, which I believe hosted it the past six years prior.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have a theme yet, but it's always a fun event. I mean, it's just the event where you have the live auction, silent auction. We have an adoption garden as well, where people can actually donate money to sponsor the adoptions for pets. So a family comes in, you know, the fee is already waived, and that really kind of helps put focus on harder to adopt animals, the bigger ones, you know, ones with medical issues. We just had somebody come in and sponsor a dog that had heartworms in the memory of a loved one that they lost, which helped cure the animal of heartworms, and now it's ready to find a forever home. So it's really a lot of money's raised at that event, and a lot of good comes out of it. So for people that have attended or would like to attend, just keep your eyes open and mark the first Saturday in May.
Well, what are some of the ways people can keep up to date with what's going on with Humane Society? You have a Facebook page.
Yes, we have a Facebook page. We have an Instagram page, our website. We have a weekly column in TC Palm, which we like to post a lot of events on. And a lot of local media outlets allow us, like this one right here, allows us to come on and highlight the events. And we also have a bi-weekly Adopt a Pet segment on our local ABC affiliate. So I always say that people are probably tired of seeing my face everywhere. So but
so that's why you wore the hat, so we couldn't see your face.
Yes, in disguise today.
Again, it's Humane Society of St. Lucie County,
mm-hmm.
Because that is the local St. Lucie County Humane Society. And people can, if you're looking for pets, my husband, he makes fun of me. Because especially the years that I've kind of haunted the Humane Society locations looking for puppies. Because sometimes the websites don't have the latest puppies, and you don't learn about the puppies or the dogs that have just come in, and by the time it's posted on the website, they're already gone. So
especially the puppies.
So best selection, you can go and you know, even if you're not ready to adopt, but you just want to kind of see the selection that's out there, or if you want to get involved as far as volunteering, helping to walk dogs, helping to take care of them, bathe them, you know, a great opportunity for service hours, especially for our young people. You know, there are a lot of young people who want to be veterinarians and or want to go into industry where they're taking care of animals, or they're trying to prove to their parents that they would be responsible pet owners. We talked a little bit about seniors and how it could change their life to have an animal that they're focusing on and have that relationship with. But, you know, also the idea of kids teaching the responsibility of taking care of other things other than yourself, whether your kid is, you know, 6 or 22, you know, there's a lot to be learned from that, the responsible pet ownership. And a lot of the material that the Humane Society provides helps you find that information. And there's also some links that link to different help things. There's all of those different blogs and what do they call when the discussion boards, you know, so you can get a lot of information about pet care from discussion boards and information about the type of dog that a lot of the different mixed breeds or breeds have websites that you can go to and check them out, figure out, or, you know, if your family is talking about getting a dog, then, you know, go check out the selection at the Humane Society and pick up a book or look on a website and look at some of the different breeds. There's a lot of advantages to getting a mixed breed, and one of them being that they tend to be more even keeled, but also, don't they have a longer life?
They do have a longer lifespan on average than a quote unquote purebred dog, absolutely. And also, it's why I always stress people to spay and neuter their pets. Not only is it important for you know, preventing its overpopulation, but on average, pets that are spayed and neutered, even they live 3 to 4 years on average, a longer lifespan.
And a lot of times they calm down. And if you have a male pet that's having trouble being house trained, a lot of times having them neutered makes a difference.
Yes, in behavior, and you know, because they. Yeah, absolutely.
They don't feel the need to mark everywhere anymore.
Yes. Yes, especially when there's a competing male in the house.
I was really worried about this. Is the with Charlie and Sammy, these are the first male dogs I've ever owned. Although we've had dogs pretty much all of our lives, and we've sometimes had a dog that we got through a breeder. We had puppies that we got through friends. We had dogs that were given to us full grown over my lifetime and over my family's lifetime. But and there'll be a time when that dog passes away, and there's lessons to be learned from that too. As a matter of fact, my cat dying when I was a preteen was the first death that I experienced. And literally 6 months later, my stepsister passed away, which at the age of, she was 15 and I was 13, and it was a big loss. But I had kind of been trained by losing the cat.
Process.
Yeah, the grieving process of how to deal with it. And so it actually was not just training for living with and nurturing a pet, but it's training for losing a loved one as well. So a big fan of pet ownership and the importance of pet ownership. So David Lynch, the surfing competition.
Surf Paul's Hang 20 is June 16th at Pepper Park. It's from 8:30 to 12. It'll be a fun, interesting event. If you've never seen dog surfing in your life, come on out. You don't want to miss it. It's going to be a blast. And then we also have a June 30th event in historic downtown Fort Pierce. Our first pup crawl we're doing. It's a pet-friendly event. It's
a pup crawl instead of a pub crawl. Okay. And that is?
That's June 30th from 2 to 6. We're partnering with Cobb's Sailfish, Second Street Bistro, and Pure Cider. All of them are pet-friendly establishments, and we're going to start off at Cobb's, end at Pure Cider, and you know, bring your pets along as well. It's going to be a fun event for sure.
And it'll also give you an idea, if you're not someone who goes out with your pets on a frequent basis, it'll give you an idea of what are pet-friendly establishments. I can remember having somebody from the Humane Society on a few years ago, and there was talk, and I don't know if this was ever put together, of putting together a pamphlet or a piece of paper or some kind of resource for pet owners that showed what pet-friendly establishments were. And I don't know if we've ever done that, but...
No, we've only really put it in place for you know, like hurricane shelter. We just put one together 2 years ago, and we keep it updated for hurricane shelters and boarding opportunities. But that'd actually be a good idea for, you know, to
for
create
leisure and, activities. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And hurricane activities, that's important too. And let's talk about the website, mm-hmm. because there's a website for the Humane Society of St. Lucie County, and that is
www.hsslc.org.
Okay, and we'll have that information here. And we'll post it for you as well, and you can call here during the work week and get that information if you miss it, or you can also Google Humane Society of St. Lucie County or like their Facebook page, mm-hmm. or Instagram, and you have Twitter as well.
Yes, we have Twitter.
So do your cats and dogs tweet?
Yeah, we should have them. We should have them speak up on there.
Yeah. My daughter's dog has her own Instagram.
Well,
yeah.
We've had a few that have gotten adopted from us that started their own Instagram account, and they one actually was traveling the world. So I was a little bit envious of that dog. I kind of want to reach out to their parents and see if they want to adopt me.
It's a great idea. There's a Instagram guy called the Dogster or something like that. I don't know, but he travels. He's a photographer who travels with his dog, and then he takes pictures of other people's dogs. And my daughter and her dog also follow that account. So they're always watching where he is because she's determined to have this guy take a picture of her pet. The relationships with people and their pets are so important, and there's something that can change them for the better, and sometimes they learn what's important. And
Absolutely. I mean, it's like with your son. I mean, it's really taught me a lesson getting involved with the Humane Society, volunteering, and then starting a job there. I mean, I was kind of just out of college, couldn't find a job, really was upset with the direction I was heading, getting frustrated, and then getting involved with the Humane Society really gave me a passion and a purpose. And, you know, I mean, it's really changed my life for the better. So, yeah.
That's awesome to hear.
Yeah.
And you know, it's something that teaches you responsibility and also the big picture in life. Mm-hmm. So David Lynch has been my guest today with the Humane Society of St. Lucie County. You've been listening to the Sue Ellen Sanders Show. The pup surfing competition is on Saturday at Pepper Park, beginning at, you said,
8:30
on June 16th. So come on out and let's check it out. I know I've never seen a dog surf, and I can't wait to. Have a great day. We'll see you next time with more.
You've been listening to the Sue Ellen Sanders Show every Monday evening in the 6 o'clock hour right here on WPSL. And archives of this show are on YouTube. To find them, just go to WPSLTV.com on the World Wide Web.